This is a special presentation from the Brighton Central School District Board of Education.
Welcome, everybody, to the Brighton Central School District Board of Education business meeting and tenure recognition for June 23rd, 2020. Please take notice that the Board of Education of the Brighton Central School District, in response to the continuing emergency circumstances caused by the COVID-19 pandemic, and consistent with the New York State Governor's executive orders, shall conduct its scheduled public business meeting this evening at 7 p.m. at 6:30 p.m. And be held via Zoom and through our streaming through the website. The public wishing to offer public comments shall be allowed to do so by participation of the video and Zoom conference. We'll discuss that a little bit later this evening as far as public participation live this evening. Further, any member of the public is encouraged to offer its comments in writing directly to the district, the board, and the superintendent. You may do that by directing an email to our board clerk, district clerk Kim Lanzafame. You're invited to write me directly as the Board of Education president or directly to Dr. McGowan as district superintendent. So we will talk a little bit about public participation after we go through our tenure event this evening. So thank you very much. First up this evening, members of the Board of Education, may I have please an approval of this evening's agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Larry, seconded by Andrea. Kim, would you call the roll, please?
Andrea?
Aye.
Larry?
Aye.
Janine? Janine?
Aye.
Karen?
Aye.
Mark?
Aye.
Christina?
Aye.
Mark?
Yes.
Thank you. Now, please, a motion for approval of the minutes from our May 26th, 2020 business meeting. Motion to approve.
Marv.
So moved by Marv. Sorry, Marv.
That's okay.
Second.
Second by Julene. Please call the roll, Kim.
Andrea. Larry.
Aye. Aye.
Julene.
Aye.
Karen.
Aye.
Mark?
Aye.
Christina?
Aye.
Barb?
Aye.
Thank you very much. Now, we start off this evening with the highlight of the evening. I know that doesn't help build the crowd toward the end, but it absolutely is. And it's a highlight of the year in a normal year. And in this year, we need every highlight that we can bring to our meeting. So we are so appreciative of all these smiling faces that have joined us this evening as we now move on to our annual approval of tenure and recognition of those receiving tenure this evening. So at this point, I'll turn it over to Dr. McGowan.
Thanks very much, Mr. Kaganovich. I appreciate it. I know there are so many teachers on this, educators on this, probably getting a kick out of us stumbling through Zoom a little bit as they spent months mastering this technology and working with young people in the greatest of challenges and did so very well. We've got a couple of people too I want to point out joining us and congratulate our newest board member, Susan Gasparino, who is also on the screen too, will be joining the board beginning July 1st. So thanks for joining us tonight, Susan, also. And so many people on the screen that are family members or in some way supportive of the people receiving tenure tonight who joined us also. And so if you're a non-Brighton employee who's just joining to support somebody, if you could give a wave on the screen also. There you go, the Blodgett kids, at least one is waving. Okay, I would like to just begin, and I know I'll say this at the end also, by thanking all of you for a moment, because the people who are receiving their tenure tonight would not be able to do so if it were not for your support of them. The countless hours that you have given up for them to do their work, for them to support our kids, and to do it in the way that they've done it here at Brighton requires a great family sacrifice. And I would like you to know, and I can say on behalf of the board, how much we appreciate what you have given to our kids by your support of their service. You've earned this tonight too, and we appreciate that and want you to know how much it is appreciated by our school community. With that, I'm gonna jump in. What I'm gonna ask you to do is after I say your name, the person receiving tenure, if you could just simply say hello. So unmute yourself and say hello. And that way everybody on here will at least see who it is and know who it is. And then you go back on mute after that. And after I'm done, when I ask for a round of applause for that person, I'd ask everybody on the screen to give the silent round of applause just simply like this. Because if we all unmute and do it, it won't work out real well. But it'll be nice for that person to see so many people, give them the love that they deserve and the support that they deserve as well. So let me jump in and start with our first tenure appointment, and that's Mr. Nate Merritt. Nate Merritt is our Director of Health, Physical Education, and Athletics, and we're very excited to be recommending him for tenure tonight. As I wrote to the board, he's worked incredibly hard to build a program that's inclusive, supportive, and focused on the needs of all students while remaining competitive at all levels as well. I am personally endlessly impressed, and I know many parents are endlessly impressed by Nate's ability to connect with each individual student and student athlete. He makes his decisions based on the needs of individual children, even when it isn't convenient for adults. And he pushes back all of the time in terms of the conversations that happen regionally, you know, in terms of our league and across the section, to make sure the conversation is always focused on what makes the most sense for all kids. And not just varsity athletes, but all kids, because he recognizes the importance of having so many kids involved in athletics. He's developed a very close relationship with many students, particularly student athletes as well, who really depend on his wise counsel, his support, his leadership. And when you ask him about just about any student he's worked with, he will talk very quickly about exactly where they're at in terms of their successes, what their challenges are. But he's able to always articulate that in a way that helps you understand it's not just about what's happening with them athletically. He often is talking about what's happening with them as a person. And the athletic piece of it comes second to that. And that's always very impressive to me. He works with other leaders in a very collaborative way to work towards solutions for all kids. And basically, as I wrote to the board, he's a good human. He means well, he does well. He's depended on by youth groups, by groups of athletes and students and educators throughout the district. I'm so excited for that and many other reasons to be recommending him to the board for tenure tonight. If you could join me in giving Nate Merritt a round of applause, please. Great job, Nate. Karen Blodgett is next up. Karen has a bachelor's degree in biology and chemistry from Vanderbilt University, a master's from the University of Delaware in education, permanent certification in biology, chemistry, general science, and earth science, all 7 through 12. And she was a teacher in the middle school at Fairport of Science, Chemistry and Living Environment, Rush Henrietta, and we were so fortunate for her to join us as a biology and chemistry teacher beginning in 2017 at Brighton High School. Tom Hall remarks, based on his observation in biology and chemistry classes throughout the year and in the past years, she is professional, competent, passionate, caring, enthusiastic, and extremely reflective and collaborative. She goes above and beyond the call of duty to develop positive relationships with her students and is open to working with them throughout the day. She works tirelessly to create an instructional environment that emphasizes individualized instruction, collaboration, argument-driven inquiry. That sounds like conversations with my teenagers at home. Argument-driven inquiry and activity-centered and inquiry-based learning. Matt Como remarks that Karen is an excellent science teacher. She teaches both biology and chemistry, is conscientious, works hard to help all of her students succeed. She's flexible and always looking for ways to improve the learning experience for her students. She's truly an asset to her students, to the science department, and to Brighton High School. For that reason and many more, we are so excited to be recommending Karen for a tenure appointment this evening. Please join me in giving her a round of applause. Great job, Karen.
Thank you.
It's now my pleasure to recognize Adrian Forkin. Adrian has a bachelor's degree in social studies and history from SUNY Fredonia, a master's in reading and literacy from SUNY Geneseo, certification in social studies and literacy, social studies 7 through 12, literacy 5 through 12. She was a social studies teacher at Joanna Perrin Middle School and then Berger Middle School before coming to 12 Corners in 2016. She's also been the chess team advisor here at Brighton in the past. Of course, she's working at the middle school, as I mentioned. She's done a phenomenal job in the middle school, extremely dependable from Mr. Thomas's remarks, especially impressed him with her collaborative nature, ability to connect with her students, her knowledge of instructional strategies. She's professional, warm, personable, and well-respected by students and her teaching team. She manages classes easily, works well with special education teachers to support students with the teaching assistants in her classes. She takes initiative, pays close attention to the details of her instruction. Her lessons are very, very well thought out. She's highly organized and carefully uses formative assessments to help her students learn based on their individual needs. She's always more than happy to participate in student events and chaperone for school activities. She's engaged with each and every one of her students and the school at large. It's for that and many other reasons that we recommend Adrian for tenure this evening. Please join me in giving her a round of applause. And I didn't do it before, but Karen said thank you, and so I skipped right over the say hi part. Nate Mayer, can you give us a wave?
Or a hello? Hey, hi, everyone.
And Adrian Forkin, can you say hello as well? Okay, Adrian, I don't see Adrian. I didn't hear Adrian. Okay, we'll keep moving. Crystal Forsythe. Crystal, where are you? Can you say hello?
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Crystal. Crystal has a bachelor's degree in phys ed from SUNY Brockport, a master's in health education from St. Bonaventure, professional certificates in health and physical education. She was a teacher in the Hackley Schools in Tarrytown, New York, teaching health and physical education before coming to Brighton in 2014 part-time as a health and phys ed teacher, and then 2016 until now full-time as a phys ed teacher. She has also coached AV field hockey and been an assistant modified track and cross-country coach as well. As Dr. Rio said, she's a phenomenal educator who values kindness, caring, relationships in her work and with our kids each day. When you walk into her classroom, you're immensely welcomed with a sense of community. Students are always collaborating, learning together. She makes each one of her PE classes full of enriching and connecting experiences. She's a strong leader, not only with the Fres PE team, but also in working with her colleagues district-wide. She's a lifelong learner. She always tries new strategies. In fact, for example, using circles, restorative circles, and joined the community building circles at Fres and was one of the special area representatives. She takes time to get to know every student that she works with on an individual level, and it's certainly no easy task to do that in teaching so many students as a special area teacher. She connects with homeroom teachers to collaborate, attends intervention meetings, and is always seeking to find ways to meet the needs of her students. She's established herself as a leader in the department, continues to be an innovator in her classroom, and brings new ideas to her kids daily. She is a great teammate with other teachers and has made the larger community better because of her efforts. For that and so many other reasons, we recommend Crystal for tenure tonight. Can you join me in giving her a round of applause? Great job, Crystal. I'd now like to recognize Michelle Hill. Michelle, can you give a wave? There's Michelle.
Hello, thank you.
All right, Michelle. Michelle Hill is a social studies 7 through 12 certified teacher. She also has students with disabilities and social studies 5 through 12, rather. She's a graduate with a bachelor's degree from Siena College in history education, a master's in inclusive adolescent education from Nazareth, was a social studies teacher in Wayne from 2009 to 17 until coming to Brighton in 2017. She's also been our Washington trip coordinator. She grew up in Ontario, New York, graduated from Wayne Central, and as we said, earned her bachelor's from Siena and moved on to Nazareth. She joined us in 2017 and has had the benefit of having taught 11th and 12th grade social studies, special education in grade 7, and even ESL for 1 year to second, third, and fourth grade children in Thailand. All of this added experience has helped in her ability to differentiate and participate in assisting students with language acquisition and upper level classes. She is upbeat, energetic, always has a positive outlook, makes strong connections with her students, plans engaging lessons, helps her students learn the content, but also guides them to look at history with a more critical lens to debunk the commonly held myths about American history. In one such activity, her students study the Pilgrim's arrival in America and create a more realistic account of the relationship between Native Americans and Europeans. She has an excellent professional attitude, collegial nature, knowledge of the content, deep connections with students. Those all contribute to her making a strong connection to the Brighton learning community. For that and so many other reasons, we recommend her for tenure tonight. Congratulations, Michelle. It's now my pleasure to recognize Christine Hodgson. Christine, can you give us a wave and say hello?
Hi, thank you.
Great, Christine. Good to see you. A bachelor's degree in psychology from Nazareth College. Christine also has a master's in inclusive education from Nazareth College, permanent certification in special education, pre-K, kindergarten, and grades 1 through 6. Her teaching experience includes grades pre-K through 8, self-contained teacher at Mary Cariola Children's Center before coming to us in 2016 as a special education teacher, of course, at Council Rock. Mr. Tappan writes that he's pleased to recommend Christine for a tenure appointment in our school district. based on her extensive experience and her excellence with all children. She runs one of the most incredibly organized and effective classrooms that he has ever seen. With students that have a variety of different ability levels, somehow she manages to create a cohesive curriculum and incredibly connected environment for each one of her children. She treats them, in every child in her care, as if they were one of her own children, always advocating for their best interests, supporting them in whatever their next step is in learning, and connecting with them. She works with many adults as well and supports each and every one of them. The classroom runs like a well-oiled machine. Because of her incredible communication skills, organization, and leadership, people know their roles, they know the expectations, and they're able to each support children so well. She does an incredible job connecting with the parents and families of each one of her children as well, clearly communicates their progress, shares the big and the little victories. Parents feel informed, empowered, and a real part of the team. She completes her probationary period demonstrating excellence in teaching and leadership, kindness, caring, and compassion for each one of her children. It is for this and so many other reasons that we recognize her and recommend her for tenure this evening. Congratulations, Christine Hodgson. Jen Clear, can you give us a wave, Jen?
Hi.
Oh, Jen. Perfect. Good to see you, Jen. Jen has a bachelor's degree in secondary social studies and history from SUNY Cortland and a master's in education from SUNY Brockport. She's permanent certification in social studies 7 through 12. She is a social studies teacher at All Saints Junior High School in Rochester and then Wayne Central School District before coming here as a part-time teacher in 2016, part-time social studies teacher, and then becoming full-time in 2017. Dr. Hall is pleased to recommend Jen for tenure this evening. His observations of her this year and his informal interactions with Jen over the years have demonstrated her incredible caring, thoughtful, talented, professional, extremely collaborative personality. She is a tremendous gift for working successfully with all kinds of learners, goes out of her way to develop positive relationships with her students and their parents. She's been actively involved with students in the AIM program and in the regular classroom setting throughout the year. She works very hard to ensure that all students feel success. She's created an exceptional learning environment as her room is welcoming and friendly. Students are actively involved in lessons, on task, and free to participate in the class period. Mr. Pincelli has said she's a dedicated and highly student-centered teacher. In particular, in her work as a social studies teacher in the AIM program, she has shown an ability to connect to her students and to support their success in and out of the classroom in all ways. She's an asset to her students, to the social studies department, and to Brighton High School. We are so proud to be recommending her at this time, and it is for this and many other reasons we are extremely excited for her to receive tenure in our school district. Please join me in congratulating Jennifer Clear. Dr. Rachel Lauber.
Good evening, everyone.
Hi, Rachel.
Hi.
Rachel has a bachelor's degree in music education from Ithaca College, a master's degree in violin performance and conducting from Bowling Green State University, and a doctoral degree in conducting from the University of Michigan. Her certification is permanent in music. She was a music teacher, orchestra, and choir in the Lansing Central School District, a strings teacher in the Webster School District, a strings teacher in Pittsford and Rush Henrietta, before finding a home with us at Brighton High School in 2017. We couldn't be more excited that Dr. Lauber did. Dr. Hall's classroom observations of Rachel this year and informal interactions demonstrated her incredible devotion and enthusiastic love for students and the job that she does. She is regularly sitting among her students during rehearsal, listening to them play from where they actually sit. She asks students for help in directing and involves them in planning the concerts and musical performances. In fact, due to the auditorium construction this year, she created and planned authentic performance events in collaboration with her students. She has created an exceptional learning environment. Her room is welcoming and friendly. Students are always on task and free to participate throughout the class period. She's developed several carefully maintained routines and procedures to keep her class organized. Dr. Lehner has remarked that she's a creative problem solver, always looking for unique opportunities to showcase the work of her students. She's worked collaboratively with other members of the music department to present selections from the opera Candide, organized informal concert settings such as The Shed, and worked with the BF to host an upcoming concert at the Memorial Art Gallery. She's truly an asset to her students, to the music department at Brighton High School. We are so proud and excited to be recommending her for tenure for this and so many other reasons. Congratulations, Dr. Lauber. Great work. Lonnie Mazurowski.
Hi.
There's Lonnie. Lonnie has quite literally never left Brighton. We'll talk more about that. Lonnie's education consists of a bachelor's degree in childhood education from SUNY Geneseo and a master's in reading and literacy from SUNY Geneseo, professional certification in childhood education, grades 1 through 6, literacy birth through grade 6, and grades 5 through 12 literacy as well. She was a fifth grade teacher long-term sub at French Road and then joined us as a probationary teacher in 2017. She also has served as a K-5 technology mentor. Although receiving tenure this year, as I had mentioned, Lonnie has been with Brighton since she graduated from high school, working in a variety of capacities, including an academic support instructor, long-term sub, substitute teaching assistant, before we were able to hire her as a probationary teacher. She's committed, an exemplary educator who goes above and beyond in her work with students, colleagues, and families each day at French Road. Her connections to our students, as well as her dedication to continue learning around best instructional practices and rigorous curriculum, truly exemplify her strengths as a classroom teacher. One of the greatest strengths of Lonnie is her ability to include her classroom families in the work that she does each day by embracing each of them as an extension of her classroom. She exemplifies our Fresh Start qualities in her interactions with all students and colleagues. Her classroom is a collaborative learning community where she makes sure that all students get the support that they need. She has an innate ability to make each individual student feel special, and she uses what she knows about her students to plan individualized instruction each day. We've enjoyed our visits to Lonnie's classroom. Personally, I could say myself and board members, working through and observing her use of restorative practices in a beautiful manner to support the building of community in her classroom. She's dedicated to each and every child with kindness, compassion, and inspiration. She's always shown a desire to learn and grow as an educator. For this and so many other reasons, we're excited to be recommending Lonnie for a tenure appointment. Congratulations, Lonnie. Great work. Adele. Where's Adele?
Hi.
And Adele?
You're not going to try.
Really hard.
It's perfect. Woo!
No, it's not. Moskovicius.
See, but every time Matt says it, he says it with this flair, and I just can't master it. But I will tell you, my 8-year-old daughter Emma says it well and says to me all the time, Daddy, why can't you say it?
I believe it.
Adele said it was all right. Adele, you don't have to say that. Tenure's in the bag for you already. Don't worry about it. But let me just say, Adele, who I think is the most popular, wonderful Adele, not the singer Adele. This is, to me, Adele, by one name only, clearly, is a librarian at Council Rock, a bachelor's degree in music from Ithaca College, and a master's in library science from Simmons College. She has permanent certification as a school media specialist and in music as well. She was a school librarian in Webster from 2001 to 2004, and then Gates Chile until 2017, and then has been with us since 2017. We're very fortunate that she decided to come to Brighton. Mr. Tappan was very excited to recommend Adele for a tenure appointment. She has been known as a calm, cool, thoughtful, and 100% collected educator. She's incredibly intelligent, brings her own knowledge of literature, libraries, and kids to her job each day. She is flexible, a team player, and very patient. Her input into our building project has also been very important. It's thoughtful, it's forward-thinking. She's willing to do the research that is needed to plan for success in whatever she chooses to do. Students flock to the library because of the environment of respect and kindness that she has created with her staff. She completes her probationary period having demonstrated excellence in teaching and leadership, kindness, compassion, and a deep concern about the needs of each child that she works with. She knows the literature that they like and the books that they enjoy reading and finds them for them as individuals. She's an incredibly dedicated educator and is most deserving of a tenure appointment for this and so many other reasons. We're excited to offer that this evening. Congratulations, Adele. Rachel O'Gorman.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Rachel. Rachel has a bachelor's degree in inclusive childhood, middle education, and history from Nazareth College, and a master's in education and literacy, also from Nazareth College. Initial certifications in childhood education, grades 1 through 6, students with disabilities, grades 1 through 6, general middle childhood education, 5 through 9, students with disabilities, 5 through 9, social studies, 5 through 9, students with disabilities, social studies, grades 5 through 9. a utility player that can play every spot on the field. From 2016 until now, she's been a kindergarten and first grade teacher at Council Rock Primary School, and she served through this past year as a K-5 technology mentor as well. Thank you for that, Rachel. Mr. Tapman is so pleased to recommend her for tenure. She's the quintessential primary school teacher. I speak to this with personal experience, having watched my daughter spend her year in kindergarten in the most wonderful environment with Rachel. She's kind, wonderful with kids, organized, calm, and incredibly adept at her craft. She emits love and positivity in everything she does, and this definitely shines through when you see her in her classroom with her students. She's a leader among her colleagues, as I said, acting as a technology mentor, as well as leading the way with innovations in ELA instruction. She's reflective in her practice, always looking to find ways to fine-tune her teaching. She's a teacher who is quite young, but you would never know it in her actions and how she presents herself. She is wise and mature beyond her years, as Mr. Tapman said. It's been such a pleasure to see her in action. She completes her probationary period, demonstrating excellence in teaching and leadership. Her knowledge, skill set, kindness, and calm demeanor, her dedication to her profession, and incredible compassion for the students she teaches are all reasons why we recommend her for tenure this evening, with so many other attributes as well. Congratulations, Rachel. Great work. Marguerite, go Pat.
Hi, everyone.
Hi, Marguerite. Bachelor's degree in psychology from SUNY Brockport. Marguerite also has a master's in psychology from SUNY Brockport and a master's as a school counselor from the University of Rochester, permanent certification as a school counselor. She began her career at Monroe Middle School as a counselor, went to James Madison School of Excellence, and then to St. Kateri School before going to Easter Andequoy and finally coming to French Road in 2017. Dr. Rio says she's pleased to recommend Mrs. Marguerite Oped for a tenure appointment. She is an extraordinary educator whose work with our students, teachers, and parents goes above and beyond expectations. She demonstrates each and every day compassion and kindness for all. She shows initiative, takes the lead on school and district-wide initiatives around social emotional learning. For example, her work with community building circles and Second Step. Marguerite also led the counseling department in this work by taking a role as a leader and supporting teachers and students in this learning. Her positivity, strong energy around the work encourages her colleagues to take risks because they know they have her support as they learn and grow. She has deep connections and great relationships with students. They are simply extraordinary. She knows how to support each student and the individual ways that that support is best for each one of them, whether it's a quick greeting in the hall, a check-in during class, or a scheduled visit. Students seek her out each and every day. Faculty do as well. She is a calm and even nature. She thinks of creative ways to solve problems. She has deep connections with Frez families. There's not a day that goes by where she does not check in on the homeschool connection for one of her students, and it's her expertise that's valued by families and staff alike. She has deep counseling knowledge, a kind and compassionate personality, and a great presence that make her a joy to work with each and every day. She's deeply committed to the school and the district, and we're proud and honored for this and many reasons to recommend her for tenure this evening. Congratulations to Marguerite. Stephanie Pappas. Where's Stephanie?
Hi.
Hi, Stephanie. Stephanie has a bachelor's degree in childhood and special education from SUNY Fredonia, a master's in reading and literacy education from SUNY Geneseo. Professional certification in childhood education grades 1 through 6. She was a special education teacher in Virginia schools before coming to Brighton in 2016 as a first and second grade teacher at Council Rock. She's an incredible teacher, Mr. Tapman says, who works to create an environment that empowers her students and where students can thrive. She's extremely knowledgeable about curriculum and uses many strategies in her possession to reach all of her children. Every day she shares her flexible mindset with students, modeling how to problem solve and adjust to new situations. She's an excellent communicator. She works well with parents and families to best support her students. She's collaborative with her colleagues, always eager to be part of a team, recognizing the power of true collaboration. She's calm, cool under pressure, and thoughtful in everything that she does. She demonstrates excellence in teaching and leadership. She has knowledge, experience, demonstrates a growth mindset, incredible dedication to her profession, and compassion for each child. She cares deeply about the students that she works with and develops deep connections with her students and their families. She is most deserving of a tenure appointment. It's for this and many other reasons we recommend her this evening. Congratulations. Great job, Stephanie. Colleen Parent.
Hello.
Hi, Colleen. Colleen has a bachelor's degree in theater, arts, and English literature from Nazareth College, a master's in literature from SUNY Cortland, permanent certification in English language arts, 7 through 12. She was an English teacher in Cortland before going to Rush Henrietta, and then coming to Brighton High School briefly in 2015 for a one-year assignment. Back to Rush Henrietta in 16-17, we were fortunate that she gave us another shot and came back when we had an opening in 2017. She's also been a director of our 24-hour plays, the Thespian Club, spring drama as well, the fall drama, the spring production, the music, the winter musical as well, very involved in the theater arts. Dr. Hall writes that his personal classroom observations of Colleen Parent last year and informal interactions throughout this year clearly demonstrated her incredible caring, enthusiastic, talented, professional, and extremely collaborative personality. She is a great gift for successfully working with all kinds of learners. She goes out of her way to develop positive relationships with her students and their parents. She's taken on various director roles in the VPA department, as we mentioned. She directed all three shows last year and has incredible rapport with her students, and many of her art of acting students have become participants on stage in our productions. For the past 2 years, she's also taken groups of students to the NYSTEA conference, where kids get hands-on instruction in all areas of performance. Mike Pincelli remarks that she's an outstanding asset to the Brighton High School English Department. Her work in the classroom is student-centered, creative, highly engaging for all children, and her work with the high school's theater program continues to produce fantastic shows while keeping the teaching and learning of the craft at the center of the theater. Colleen is an asset to her students, the English department in Brighton High School. She deeply connects with all children. She is passionate by her work and a compassionate educator. For this and so many reasons, we are so excited to recommend Colleen for a tenure appointment this evening. Congratulations to Colleen. And Charlie says, thanks for a great year too, Colleen. Brian Slocum. Brian, where are you? Is Brian here? Last call. Okay. Crystal Stack.
Hi, everyone.
Great. And don't worry, we will also do a round of applause for Brian when we do all the appointments in the whole list, certainly with that too. But I don't want to keep anybody any longer than we have to. But I'll say thanks to Brian on behalf of my son Peter, who also had Brian this year. I feel like half the people here probably have had class with either Peter or some of our board members' kids, actually, ironically. Crystal has a bachelor's degree in special and childhood education from Canisius and childhood literacy education also from Canisius. Professional certifications in students with disabilities, grades 1-6, and childhood education, grades 1-6. She was a first grade long-term sub at Council Rock from 2015 to 16, and has been a special education teacher at Council Rock from 2016 until now. Crystal has been a wonderful addition, Mr. Tappan writes, to the special education team at Council Rock. She's teaching in the 1211 program currently. She's incredibly organized, extremely thoughtful in her practice, makes great connections with students, families, and other staff members. She's a very reflective practitioner, always taking feedback and incorporating it into her practice to continually improve. She's grown in her role as a case manager for her students and families, learning how to effectively communicate progress and connect families with the resources they need to be successful as well. She's dedicated to educating the whole child, is flexible, kind, caring, and will do anything to ensure the success of her students. She completes her probationary period having demonstrated excellence in teaching and leadership. She has a reflective nature, willingness to learn and grow, and a great dedication to her profession and the children that she teaches. It is for this and so many reasons we recommend her for tenure this evening. Congratulations, Crystal. Jessica Wasserman. Did see Jessica?
Hi.
There she is. Hi, Jess.
Hi.
Jess has a bachelor's degree in history from Western New England University and inclusive adolescence education master's from Nazareth College. Professional certifications in students with disabilities, grades 7-12, journalist, and professional in social studies, students with disabilities 7-12, and social studies certification 7-12. She was a social studies teacher in Rush Henrietta from 2014 to 15, and then Spencerport, and then came to Brighton High School in 2016. She also has worked in our Credit Recovery Institute and been both a modified field hockey coach and currently the varsity field hockey coach, and done great work in those areas as well. Dr. Hall writes that observations in Jessica's resource room and ICT classes, along with informal interactions with Jessica in meetings and department meetings, show her to be professional, competent, caring, enthusiastic, and extremely collaborative. She has a gift for successfully working with all kinds of learners. She works diligently to create an instructional environment that emphasizes individualized instruction, respect, engagement, activity-centered learning. Her classroom is a warm and inviting place for students to come and learn. We've seen kids laughing, completely engaged, and having fun while learning under Jessica's guidance in the classroom. She's approachable and easy to talk to about kids, instruction, and specific concerns. Teresa Mosher, assistant principal at BHS, has remarked that she has worked with her over the past 2 years, and she has demonstrated incredible professionalism, a rapport with colleagues, is versatile in supporting both the ICT math and English courses. She's highly organized, established positive relationships with students, and she engages each child through differentiated, challenging lessons. She's prepared for meetings and takes a collaborative approach with families when creating and implementing support plans for students. An active member of the school community in so many ways. I mentioned field hockey, but also being on the care and wellness committee. She's an asset to her student and her department and to Brighton High School. We're very proud for this and so many reasons to recommend Jessica Wasserman for tenure this evening and congratulate to Jess Wasserman. I'd like to move on now to our teaching assistant tenure area recommendations as well. Jill Bowler, are you with us tonight? Elise Cox.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Elise. Good to see you. Elise has a bachelor's degree in psychology from Long Island University, a level 3 teaching assistant certification as well. She was a teaching assistant at 12 Corners Middle School, a teacher aide at 12 Corners, a teacher aide at Council Rock, and a teaching assistant now at Council Rock as well. She's well known in the building and through the administrators to be dependable, kind, thoughtful, dedicated to each child that she works with, and exceptionally competent in helping get them to the place that they need to be. She individualizes instruction, supports the teachers that she works with, and does everything to help the children she is supporting be successful in each and every activity that they participate in. Please join me in congratulating Elise on her tenure appointment this evening. Great work, Elise.
Thank you.
Ruth Forneri. Congratulations to Ruth. We'll keep going. Catherine McQueen.
Hello, everyone.
Hi, Katie. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Excellent. Good to see you. A bachelor's degree in communication from SUNY Brockport is what Catherine came to us with. Also a level 1 teaching assistant certification. She was a teaching assistant part-time at Council Rock in 2015 and then became a probationary teaching assistant in 2016, also at Council Rock, and then moved to French Road beginning in 2017. Kathy greets each day with a smile and every child she works with enthusiasm. She is kind, compassionate, connected, does everything she can to help each child be successful, is well organized, follows through on each task, and helps each and every teacher that she has been assigned to and worked with and the children she works with have their best day they can ever have. She works carefully to complete tasks and to help children be successful in each assignment that they are given. Congratulations to Kathy McQueen. We're very excited for you and your tenure appointment this evening. Candace Pierce. Gail Saki.
Hello.
Oh, Gail's there.
I'm here.
Gail completed coursework at Mohawk Valley Community College and is a level 3 teaching assistant as well, was a teaching assistant part-time 2015 through 16, and then became full-time a teaching assistant probationary at Council Rock in 2016. Gail is also known as a thoughtful, kind, collaborative teaching assistant, one that works with each teacher and child to make sure that those children are having an outstanding learning experience each and every day. She's very quick to be individually working with children when she sees them struggling, to take an interest in their individual needs, their gifts, their talents, and their experiences, to share her own personal experiences, to share her life experiences, and to help children feel appreciated each and every day for who they are and what they bring to the table. She helps each and every one of them be successful in all of their work. She's kind, she's compassionate, she's a shoulder for them to lean on and a person for them to laugh with. For this and so many other reasons and the personal connection she has with children, we congratulate Gail on her 10-year appointment.
Thank you.
Emma thanks you also, Gail.
Say hi to Emma for me.
I will, for sure. Lori Trovato? That concludes our tenure appointments in recognition. I'd like to ask Mr. Kikanovich.
I think Lori's here. Didn't I see Lori in there?
She's on page Lori two. Was on, Kevin, but she must have had to hop off.
Okay. Well, we congratulate each and everyone.
She's here. She's muted. She can't, maybe she can't unmute. I see her.
I do too.
Yeah.
Oh, great.
But she can hear us.
Hold on one second.
Okay, can you hear me now?
There you go. Hi, Lori.
Hi, hi.
Lori has a bachelor's degree in psychology from SUNY Brockport as a level 2 teaching assistant. Was a teacher aide at Council Rock in 2013, a teaching assistant in 2014, a teacher aide teaching assistant in 2015, and in 2016 became a teaching assistant again at Council Rock. Congratulations to Lori on this appointment. Lori is known as a kind, compassionate teaching assistant who works on helping each and every child be successful through their battling each individual challenge that they have. She's there for every teacher. She completes tasks assigned. She is dependable. She is kind. She is thoughtful. She works with groups of children, helps them feel as though they are included in the classroom and included in every aspect of Council Rock life. She makes sure that each child has their best day possible. She is a thoughtful educator who ensures the success of every child in her charge. Congratulations, Lori, on her tenure appointment this evening. Please join me.
Thank you. Lori.
Mr. Kikanovich.
Thank you, Dr. McGowan, and thank you for all of the folks who were able to be on all of our screens tonight. What a great way. It's not the usual way, and it's much better when we can all be in the boardroom, but this is not a bad session. At this point, I will ask the Board of Education for a motion, please, to approve the list of tenure as outlined on our agenda this evening.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Karen and seconded by Julene. Kim, would you please call the roll?
Andrea?
Aye.
Larry?
Aye.
Julene?
Aye.
Karen?
Aye.
Mark?
Aye.
Christina?
Aye.
Barb?
Yes.
And our congratulations to everyone. Thank you so much. We appreciate all that you do. Dr. McGowan outlined each of you individually, but collectively from the Board of Education, thanks for joining in this evening. Thanks for all that you do and have been doing, especially over these difficult past few months. And we're certainly happy to make it an official version of the Brighton Family Edition tonight. So thank you so much. Glad hands one more time around for everybody this evening. I could like that kind of thing. We also have tonight some retiree recognition from our four building principals. Each of them have a couple of words, I believe, that they want to say. So we'll start off this evening with Matt Tappan, if we could. You weren't ready for that. I didn't know what order I was supposed to go in. And never know. I didn't know if Dr. Hall was still trying to drive a senior car parade out in the thunder and lightning or what happened there.
I think Dr.
Hall's in the top of a fire truck. Ms. Balling will be playing the role of Dr. Hall this evening.
Oh, okay. Correct. So she's doing that. Okay. I hope Tom's not high up on that fire truck driving around. But anyway, we'll start with Matt anyway, and then we'll work our way up the ladder. How's that?
Sounds great. So I have four retirees, so I'm going to go in alphabetical order. Janine Heyer. I don't think I saw Janine in here. Janine, are you in? So Janine retires from Brighton and Council Rock after 14 years as an amazing teaching assistant at Council Rock. Most of Janine's work has been with our students in our 1214. Her connection and love for each of the students that she works with is evident the minute you see her in action. Janine owns several salt and freshwater fish tanks and takes pride in sharing her babies with everyone at Council Rock. We know that will keep her busy in her retirement. Janine also, if you've been to any special event at Council Rock, was Council Rock's resident baker, baking several hundreds of dozens of cookies over the years, supplying our volunteer receptions, bus drivers, and many other willing eaters with the most amazing and beautiful cookies you have ever seen or eaten. We wish Janine all the best as she retires. I know that she will never be bored as she will reinvent herself and continue to challenge the world and change the world. So congratulations to Janine. Our next retiree is Lori Magnolo. I know Lori was in here, so Lori, say hello.
Hello, everybody.
Hi, Lori is retiring after 28 years with the district, starting as a kindergarten teacher, working for 10 years, then looping as a first and second grade teacher for 13 years, and finishing her career back at kindergarten for the last 5 years. While in the classroom, Lori shared her love of learning, which is contagious, and her love of nature with each of her students and with me when I happened to be in her room. She was always the very first person to be with me in any type of crisis. So whether it was a late bus or a crazy windstorm that brought down trees and had us out, she was there. She was the first on the scene with me and always the last to leave with me. Lori's love of learning will not stop with her retirement, as I am sure she will continue to change the world one child or person at a time with whatever she chooses to do. We wish Lori all the best in her retirement. So congratulations to Lori.
Thank you.
Terry Nee, I don't think I saw Terry in here, but if Terry's in here, unmute yourself. Terry retires after only 2 years at Council Rock as a teaching assistant, but many other years in the educational system. Her time was short, but her impact was huge. Terry previously worked as a teaching assistant in Webster for many years. Her kind, loving, and supportive way has helped many students while working at Council Rock. Terry was one of the most positive people on the morning bus circle, no matter what the weather. She was always greeting me and every child with a smile or a high five or a hello. And I could always tell if the weather was really cold when Terry wore a jacket, as she only wore it when it was below zero because she said it wasn't cold otherwise. So I always knew whether it was going to be a really cold day. So we wish Terry is congratulations as she continues on with her path. She just had a grandchild, a granddaughter, so we wish her congratulations. So hopefully she's tending to her right now. Congratulations to Terry. And last but not least, I don't think I saw him in here either, Harry Wood. Harry is retiring after 6 years in Brighton as our security guard at Council Rock. Previously, Harry worked for 30 years at Kodak. Upon retiring, he actually returned to Kodak as a consultant in a different capacity for 14 more years. Harry's kind, chivalrous way has been a perfect fit for the very first security guard for our primary school kids and families. We wish Harry the best as he starts this next phase of retirement, and I hope that this time it sticks for him and for his wife, Judy, and they can enjoy their time with their children and grandchildren. So congratulations to Harry. And that's it for me. Am I passing it off?
I'm playing by the rules, so I can only hear me. Thank you so much. We appreciate it. And all the best to all four of the retirees that you brought to us this evening. We'll move over to French Road and Dr. Allison Rio.
Hello, everyone. I figured I was next, Matt, so I was ready to go after you. We also have four retirees to celebrate at French Road this year. And I think everyone's here on the Zoom with us today, so I'll stop and let everyone say hi. I'll also go through alphabetically. And first up tonight is Mary Dubois. Mary, are you here?
Hi, everybody. Good to see you.
I thought you were in there, Mary. So Mary is retiring from French Road after teaching fifth grade for almost 30 years in Brighton, and before that she taught third grade, fifth grade, and sixth grade in West Virginia. Mary has done a ton of work within our Brighton community, from being a team leader to a mentor to summer work, curriculum writing, everything you can imagine, and Mary was part of support for everyone and everything all the time. Her love and connection to students has never wavered right until the end of the school year. Phenomenal work with kids, and I'm just so proud of Mary. She even shared with me that she Zoomed with the graduating class this year, who were her fifth grade students, so kids are still connected to her even right now as they are graduating as seniors. So Mary, we're really gonna miss your commitment to creativity, including the courtyard, your acting, and everything else you do, but we're so proud of you. Congratulations, Mary, enjoy your retirement, and we know where to find you to say hi. Congratulations, Mary.
Thank you.
Next up, we have Patty French.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Patty. Patty, are you on the boat?
I am.
Nice. So Patty French is retiring after over 30 years working at French Road in a variety of positions. She's leaving us this year as our math intervention specialist, but she's also worked over the years as a special education teacher, fourth grade teacher, and team leader, math instructional coach, and many, many other roles involving curriculum, data, student support, you name it, Patty did it. Patty is the kind of person who is always there when you need her, even when you don't know that you do. She has helped so much. I can, you know, anytime we're on the bus loop, fire drills, anything going on, Patty's there and ready to support. And her love and care for our school community, including all the adults and the kids, will be greatly missed. So congratulations to Patty. Enjoy your boat and sunshine this summer and beyond. Congrats.
Thank you, everyone.
Next up, we have Carol Jeffries. Carol, are you here?
Hey, everybody. How you doing?
Hi, Carol.
Hey.
Carol is retiring as a teaching assistant at French Road after joining us in 2005. She has been a wonderful part of our Brighton and French Road community, and she was even a Brighton High School graduate herself. Her connections and care for the kids that she works with is really outstanding, and she's always positive and has a great, bright smile, even when she's on lunch duty in the cafeteria. So congratulations to you, Carol. We know you're going to enjoy the next chapter focusing on your love and care of your grandkids. Congrats, Carol. And last but not least, we have Michelle Ryersey.
Hi, everyone.
Michelle. Hi, Michelle. Michelle Hi. Is retiring from Prez after teaching 20 years with us here at French Road as the extended teacher. And prior to that, Michelle worked at a few different schools in Rochester, also as an extended studies teacher. She really always is such a strong advocate for students and learning, and she's a valued part of our team. And she's the type of person who has always been up for trying something new and taking the lead of whatever the kids want to try in the classroom, which I have always been so impressed with. I know she probably won't actually miss the math team meetings every Friday when those start, and we'll miss her next year when those come up in March, but we're really going to miss you around every day. Best of luck in your retirement, Michelle. Congratulations.
Thank you.
That's the last one for us at French Road. Congratulations, everyone.
Great. Thank you, Allison, and congratulations to all those folks, too. We appreciate them, and we wish them all the best in their retirement. So we'll move on to honor our retirees from middle school, Rob Thomas.
Thanks, Mark, and congratulations to all the retirees. There are four from the middle school, and I know Ella Schulteis is on Zoom tonight. Hi, Ella.
Hi, Rob. Hi, everybody.
Ella's retiring after 30 years teaching physical education in Brighton. The last 6 years, Ella taught at 12 Corners, but most of her career was spent at French Road Elementary School, a school she also attended with me. Ella is a Brighton High School graduate. We graduated together a few years ago, and she was recently married this spring and is now Ella Madlin. Congratulations, Ella. Enjoy the time with your two daughters and your son, who I forgot at our building meeting, and your new husband. Very happy for you, Ella.
Thank you, everyone.
Next up, Judy Tarasek retired from Brighton in February, just before the COVID pandemic began, after 27 years as a school nurse. Judy is a Brighton High School graduate also, and before coming to Brighton, she worked in the neonatal ICU at Strong, gaining valuable experience. Judy was the camp nurse for our outdoor ed program for years and years. Congratulations, Judy. Enjoy your retirement with your husband, Jim, your two sons, and your grandchildren, who I think she's with now. Carol Price is retired from her position as a special education teacher in Brighton after 29 years. Most of her career was at TCMS, but As of late, she was working at the Westfall Academy at Harley School, but we still consider her part of the TCMS family. She was a camp archer at Outdoor Education and was a catapult creator at Medieval Days, and her activities were very, very popular. Congratulations, Carol. Enjoy your retirement with Barb, your dogs, and all of your fun hobbies. And last but not least, by any stretch of the imagination, Beth Goldberg is retiring after 40 years in Brighton as a special education teacher. Beth started at BHS when Ella and I were students. Beth's two sons are also Brighton graduates. I'm so glad she's not on the Zoom tonight to hear this. She was the team leader for her department longer than I have worked in the district. Congratulations, Beth. Enjoy the newfound time with your sons and granddaughters right here at your home in Brighton. And congratulations to all the TCMS staff that received tenure tonight as well.
Fantastic, Rob. Thank you very much. And again, our congratulations to all those folks too. Then we'll move on to the Brighton High School retiree recognition, and Betsy Balling tonight is going to do that for us.
Yeah, hi everybody. I'm honored to be taking Tom's place tonight while he is on the fire truck. He was very excited about doing that. But certainly wanted me to let everybody know that he wanted to be in both places, and not even Tom Hall can do that. So I have the honor of announcing Lynn Sanger and Tony Trauma, who are two retirees. And is Lynn on here?
Yep. Hi.
Hi, Lynn. How are you?
Good.
And we had the privilege of coming to see Lynn as an administrative group and wishing her well. But let me just read a few words here. So Lynn is retiring after 44 years of teaching, 29 years of those here in Brighton as a special education teacher. I have some fun facts. So early on in her career in Brighton, Lynn was tasked with designing and implementing a self-contained program for students who came to BHS from the Division for Youth OATCA Group Home. These were felony convicted youth about to be released back into their communities. At BHS, she provided the transition program where they were gradually integrated into regular education classes. Once the group home closed, she continued as a special education teacher at BHS and worked on a CAS in educational administration. Lynn lives on a beautiful farm in Pittsford, home of many chickens and home to the most beautiful crop of sunflowers you have ever seen. People come from miles around to get pictures in the sunflower fields each year, and they are spectacular. We had our annual retire farewell last Friday via Zoom, and Lynn plans to enjoy her retirement with her husband on the farm and will be spending a lot of time at a remote cabin in the woods. Congratulations to you, Lynn. It's been a real privilege getting to know you better this year. And Tony Trauma, is Tony on tonight? All right, I'm just gonna start. Tony Trauma is retiring after 30 years of teaching, 15 of those years here in Brighton as a social studies teacher. And Tony shared the following with his students on the last day of classes this year. Bad teachers waste lives and time, their own and those of their students. Good teachers competently teach their subjects. Great teachers give something from deep inside themselves. Tony has also run 4 marathons in 1 year, all of which were under 3 hours, and one of them was the Boston Marathon. And he was also the driving force behind getting his department to read the book Stamped from the Beginning, the definitive History of Racist Ideas in America by Ibram X. Kendi. In fact, Tony has brought in numerous guest speakers to help bring history alive. Lulu Westbrook Griffin to talk about segregation in the Deep South, Rock and Red to share the history of music, David K. Johnstone to discuss politics, and many Holocaust survivors to share their personal experiences from World War II. In our annual retire farewell last Friday, we did that on Zoom, and Tony plans to enjoy his retirement with his wife and will be spending a lot of time running now on his own schedule. Congratulations to you, Tony.
Thank you very much, Betsy, and congrats to those two Brighton High School retirees. Unfortunately, it's not the same as doing our event with all of our retirees, but nothing's the same right now. But I'm glad that we could recognize them tonight at the board meeting just the same. So all the best to those folks and everyone who's been recognized tonight. We have two more special recognitions that I'm going to turn it over to Dr. McGowan for. But before I do that, I just want to make comment. We, as those of you who looked at the agenda, saw that public comment this evening was a little bit delayed because of our recognitions. So after we finish up a couple of special recognitions, we will have opportunity for public comment. If you wish to address the board in public comment session this evening, we're going to ask you to go to the chat feature. Kevin, I'm going to have you disable that. You control that, if you will, from now on. Please go into the chat feature and just post your name that you wish to speak during public comment. You don't have to post a question. You don't have to post a topic. But we do want to be able to call on you and make sure that we get any members of the public who are with us this evening who wish to address the board during public participation. So having said that, I will turn it over to Dr. McGowan for two more special recognitions this evening. Kevin.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kakanovich. I would like to begin by recognizing one more retiree as a staff member, and that is Mr. Rob Thomas. We do know Rob is here, so he doesn't have to wave to us necessarily, but Rob, it's so good to see you. Rob has a bachelor's degree in education from SUNY Cortland, a master's in education from SUNY Brockport, and received his certificate of advanced studies from SUNY Brockport, permanent certifications in phys ed and as a school administrator supervisor. He was a phys ed teacher in Penfield from 1986. I think I could have been his student in sixth grade at that point, just saying, until 2001. And then he became an assistant principal at 12 Corners Middle School again in beginning in 2001 and was an assistant principal through 2008. He became the principal at 12 Corners Middle School in 2008 and serves in that capacity at this time. Rob is kind, he is considerate, he is thoughtful. He has a great sense of humor. He loves to give hugs. Wait a second, that's the part we're supposed to take out. However, this is a person who jokes all the time about not hugging, but I have yet to meet many people much more caring, thoughtful, considerate, and supportive of others. I think it's his shtick, but I do think Rob gives everybody a hug in his actions all of the time. In the Brighton community, he's been a coach. He's a father. Three wonderful kids, Jack, Josh, and Carly, all graduated from Brighton High School. Rob was also a Brighton graduate. Rob is fond of pointing out to people that he is principal in the building where his father attended school when it was first built as a school building here in Brighton. Many people would not know that Rob takes an individual interest in students in a variety of ways that are unseen to most. It was not uncommon during my time working with Rob to hear about Rob teaching a child who didn't know how to ride a bike at the middle school level how to ride a bike, because they needed to know that. Rob took him outside and taught him how to ride a bike. Or finding that a student would be particularly engaged in school if Rob would teach them how to play the guitar. So Rob taught him how to play the guitar. It's not something that Rob would put out there, that he'd brag about, that he'd proclaim from the mountaintops, yet he did it. And he did countless other gestures, acts of kindness towards children and staff members throughout his career that I think speak greatly to who he is as an educator. He has a great sense of humor. He's a great collaborator. He's somebody who on the leadership team we enjoy working with a great deal. We're so excited for Rob to spend time in the Adirondacks with Dee Dee. Perhaps more excited than Dee Dee for Rob to spend time with her in the Adirondacks. I'm just kidding. Dee Dee can't wait. They're very excited. He's been enjoying being a tenant this past year, still living in the district, under the roof of his son right across the street from 12 Corners Middle School and having a great commute throughout the year. I think actually one of the interesting aspects, Rob, of you living with two of your kids right now in Dee Dee across the street is the fact that your adult children want to live with you at this point and invited you to stay there while your house in the Adirondacks is being built and after your house in Brighton was sold. I think that's a pretty neat testament to who you are as a dad too. So congratulations to Rob, a great contributor to our team, and clearly since 2001 here in this district, but long before that as a student of Brighton. We're very proud of you, very glad to have worked with you, and very excited for you to have this next step in your life. So congratulations to Rob.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks, Kevin.
You bet. And last but certainly not least, after 30 years, the governor of the state of New York has commuted the sentence of Dr. Marv Sachs. And we are very, very excited for him. If you just give me 1 second to pull up a special tribute, we have something very special to share with everybody.
Uh-oh.
Not a hazing, Marv. It's not a hazing, we promise.
All good.
Okay, everybody should be able to see that.
Thank you. Oh no, that was awesome. That was just awesome.
Kevin, thank you for sharing that. Did you have anything else that you wish to add at this point?
Yes. Hold on 1 second, Marv. Let me unmute you because I think we're in a mute battle, you and I. All right, so Marv, you've got to unmute yourself, but let me say, oh, there you go. You're unmuted, but let me say this because I know you want to critique that video, and you should. I almost thought of leaving you unmuted because your reactions to the pictures were almost better than the pictures of I just wanted to say to the group, to everybody here, I don't know that there's the right words to sum up 30 years of board service. So, you know, for those on here that may not know this, I think most people do, that's 30 years of just this incredible compassion for individual student needs, this thoughtfulness, this deeply reflective decision maker who volunteered his time a minimum of 2 times a month for 30 years to simply steward the education of the children in this community. And his passion for individual student needs is unparalleled. You may have noticed in the tenure appointments and the retiree comments, there were some very common themes around individualization, around really, you know, thinking about what each child needs individually and being connected to those children. I'd like to say to everybody here, that's Marv Sachs. That started somewhere. That didn't start with anybody else in this meeting but Dr. Marv Sachs. And that legacy, Marv, will go on for a very, very, very long time. Your commitment to us, your just constant kindness, compassion, your jovial nature, your sense of humor, your thoughtfulness, just never a negative word, nothing but positive. You will joke about your criticism of whether it's the governor or this political issue or that political issue, but you're so good-natured and thoughtful that you'll joke about that, but at the end of the day, you don't have anything but kindness in your heart for everybody who you're around. And that transcends your board meeting service to really impacting the ethic of care in the school district. I know for me personally, it's been nothing but a joy to work with you. I will miss that a great deal, and I know you will still be around, which I'm very thankful for, but I wanted to know how much that meant to us as well. And just thank you so much for your service. On behalf of the thousands and thousands of thousands of children who you have impacted over the years, we thank you for that. Mark?
Well, I would just add, if I could, to that before we ask Marv to speak. I first of all, I want to thank Andrea Costanza, our board member, who kind of shepherded the idea of putting together a slideshow with Christina and Kim, and I know a lot of our tech people, and Sora. Sora's in the picture there too with Marv, his better half, but had a lot to do with helping us find material for that. So I want to thank them. I guess what I wanted to say was, first of all, a lot of you people are getting a heck of a lot older. I don't know what happened to all of you, but anyway, we will have a proper party when we can, and we can all get together. The board plans to do that whenever that may be and celebrate properly a 30-year career as a school board member. But on behalf of me, but on behalf of this board and all, I think it's 22 board members that served with you, Marv, over your career, you have been a mentor, a leader. Even when you weren't a designated leader as board president, you have a quiet way about you. You lead by example. You have shepherded us through a number of things over the years, foremost of which I am proud to tell this community listening tonight, through a very difficult time in leadership in the district that brought us Kevin 11 and a half years ago in that period of time. And, you know, you worked really hard on the leadership of the board and bringing people along in a way that they listened and moved forward. You are the epitome of a lifelong learner. You and Sora are such assets to this community. Sora, of course, most of you are aware, is our member of the BOCES One board and has been for a long time also. But the two of you, you search out parts of the world that are not on the beaten path and learn about other people, about other cultures, about other ways of life and ways of thinking, and bring that back to us. You have always been that way. You are a unique individual. The two of you are a unique couple, and I know you will continue to do that. So on behalf of all of the board members who have had the benefit of knowing you and working with you, not just for Brighton, but through Monroe County School Boards and all of those board members who interacted with you on all the committee work, thank you so much. And we will be forever in a, you know, in our debt. And we're happy to say that you're not leaving the community. Marv's already offered to serve on a number of committees as a community member. And just thank you is what I would say on behalf of board members.
I want to point out a couple of things here, Mark. There are several former board members, Rome Celli, Jody Siegel, Dr. Mort Stein, who have joined us as well, served with Marv for many years, also helped build this incredible legacy here. And I think we're led by and inspired by Marv as well, former educator at NTID, dedicated his life to the needs of all children, the particular needs. Great dad, great community member, and we're just so honored to have served with you. So thank you again, Marv, and thank you to all those that could join us. I will tell you too, Marv, that both Harv Paris and Gary Valenti couldn't make it tonight, but are looking forward to catching up with you, they said, in their own individual capacities. But each remarked in very similar fashion about the impact that you had on them and the ways that you played such an important role in front of the scenes, but also behind the scenes in so many different situations in the district to be so helpful for kids and families. So once again, if you could all join me in the applause for Marv. Congratulations to you, Marv.
Well, I'm not gonna say that I'm speechless. I'm very touched, and I appreciate everybody. I have two things to say, though. One is, this is a deaf applause. You may or may not know that. That's the way the deaf shake their do this. 36 years there was quite an event, and 30 years on the board has been absolutely unbelievable. And my hat with the B is really the Brooklyn Dodgers, but I call it my Brighton hat. And I'm not being disrespectful to anybody, but I'm not showing you my hair. That's what I'm telling you right now. It's coming back, but you could see from those pictures, I did have hair. And thanks for everybody. I enjoyed it. I don't know, Tuesday, I may have to tune in every board meeting to be sure everything's going okay.
Please do, and feel free to text during the meeting and comments. Many, many people do, so thanks. Thanks again, Marvin. Thanks to Sora. We appreciate everything that the two of you have done and will continue to do. So we are going to move on to the remainder of our agenda. Dr. McCallum, did you have?
One other item, and this is completely my fault. I would like to take one more moment with one more retiree that I did not recognize tonight, and again, very much my fault. And that's Carolyn Rabideau, our Director of Students.
Oh, yeah.
Carolyn thought that she escaped, but she didn't. I will say to you, I don't have her educational experience to rattle off to you, and she'll be okay with that. But Carolyn came from the Rush Henrietta School District, where she had been a teacher. She had also worked, I know, in her experience at Hillel, the community Jewish day school here in Brighton, and then came to Brighton as an assistant principal at French Road and worked with Dr. Hall for quite a while. We'd like to say she shaped Dr. Hall. And then she came over and began working with us as the Director of Student Services at the time, the PPS position, and has just been an incredible contributor in this district for so many years. She is, I think the best way to characterize it is like a dog on a bone. And Carolyn's persistence with making sure that program is right for children and seeing that through to the end in each individual situation is incredible. It is such an asset to the district, and the way that she has created an environment in the PPS department that is so focused on finding solutions for every child at whatever cost, and I don't mean whatever cost financially, whatever cost, to be flexible in programming, to find alternative solutions, and to really reach out and provide a network of care, a support and a web around kids and their families, and connects with them personally. So we couldn't be more grateful for Carolyn's service. She is also retiring. And again, I apologize for not mentioning that before, Carolyn. Congratulations also to Carolyn Rabideau.
Kevin, I was worried you didn't get my letter.
No, he's for you. The problem is we don't really think you're leaving. That's the problem, if he was being honest, Carolyn.
I should point out that, first of all, that was just simply denial on my part. But this is a great example. I just want to share this one very quick personal anecdote. Most recently, the extended school year program that the state of New York, particularly the governor, said schools could offer extended school year programming for students with special needs. And the problem is when that was said, it was without a lot of thought, organization, guideline, thoughtfulness, et cetera. And it was pretty much up to districts try and make it work. Oh, but by the way, here's some ways that it'll be impossible to make it work. Carolyn's reaction to that was, why not, instead of why? Carolyn's reaction was, well, we can make that happen, and we should make that happen. And this is not a commentary on other school districts. It's not. But it should be known that we will be the only district that offers in-person extended school year this summer because Carolyn, with the help of Deanna Spagnola, Lou Alamo, John Novelli, and several others said, no, we should do that. That's what our kids need. That's what families need. And we should make that happen. And let's figure out a way to do that. And it would have been very easy with about 2 weeks left in her career, by the way, to say, yeah, like every other district, it seems impossible for this reason, this reason, this reason. And those would have been very legitimate reasons. And that's not how Carolyn approached it. In fact, Carolyn's been excited right up until this moment probably, but right up until the end of her career in Brighton to do more for kids and to find ways to do that. And so we thank Carolyn for that and her service. But I think this particular project in the last 10 days exemplifies what Carolyn has been for her entire career. And what a way to have a capstone as you're leaving. And then she'll leave us and the program will go on. So Carolyn, we may be calling. I think Deanna might be, maybe on day one. And we know that you're always there for us. And thank you for all of your service, too.
Thank you, Carolyn. On behalf of the board, your role, especially in your recent role, has just been phenomenal with the board. You know, you're under the radar, but you work with our most vulnerable children and families in some of the most difficult circumstances. When you come to the board and present to us and answer our questions, it's direct, it's information we need to know, and it's an area that so many of us don't know much about on a day-to-day basis. We appreciate all that you've done for Brighton families over the years and certainly wish you nothing but the best moving forward. So thank you on behalf of the board. And one other item we want to do, Andrea texted me, Marv and Sora have a cake that they want to show. It's a special Brighton decorated cake. Geez, I hope there's no mascots on this cake. But anyway, it's a Brighton decorated cake, and there in celebration, there's a bicycle.
Yeah.
No bike shorts, but a bicycle.
10 miles today. 10 miles today.
So a special cake, and again, thanks. I think that was pretty much Andrea's doing, delivered over there to Sora, and Sora's
gorgeous
cake, and we're going to virtually all share that, I guess, somehow.
At some point. People don't realize that the first time, I think it was Mark's first year as the president, first time as the president, and Andrea was our new board member. I came in my bike shorts to the meeting. And they were aghast. I said, why? Come on. I've never lived it down.
I'm sorry to take two more seconds, but he had just been assigned to mentor Andrea. And he walked into the meeting with the bike shorts and a Curly Larry Moe t-shirt. And Andrea goes, okay, what did I get into here? But anyway.
So if you could see the top of the cake, it's got a Brighton B.
I don't know. Yeah.
It's a great.
I don't
want to
tip it.
Yeah, be careful. I don't want cake accidents here.
You might see it there.
Oh, there it is.
Yeah.
Okay.
Great
That's
job.
Beautiful.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, that helped put the celebration
together.
You deserve
together. First tonight.
See you, Marv.
That's fantastic. All right. We are going to move on now to the period of the rest of our business agenda this evening. And we do have opportunity for public comment. Dr. McGowan, did we have anybody sign up for public comment this evening?
Sure. We don't. I would just say if we could make one more call, if anybody is interested in providing public comment, if they just simply enter into the chat, they can send me All they have to do is say their name that they would like to, and then Mr. Kakanovich will call on you.
Yep, but we just don't want to miss anybody this evening. It's a little different order of business. The one thing I will add also, if there are members of the public who might be thinking about commenting, we have a period of 3 minutes that you're allowed to ask a question or make a comment. I've often said to people, if you have something that you want to really express to us that takes, most of these things take longer than 3 minutes in today's world, send us a letter, send us an email. We're happy to take stock of that and to provide a reply to you. So that's another outstanding way to communicate directly with the board. So anything, Dr. McGowan?
Nope.
All right then. Hearing no public comment this evening, we will then move on to blueprint updates. Do we have a particular order, Kevin, that you want the group to go in?
No, not at all. Whichever you would like to is fine.
All right.
If I can jump in, do you mind, Mark? Kevin, can you share hosting and I will pull up the PowerPoint? And I think, Carolyn, you may be up first. Sorry, Mark, if that's okay, but we kind of have a PowerPoint. We're ready.
I turn it over to Kevin.
Okay, I have no idea what the order is, so we'll see what comes up.
Hang on, let me share.
You're all set.
Okay. Please hold. All right. Come on. Okay, Carolyn, I think, is that you?
Okay, yeah, that's me. That's the first slide. Hello, everybody. Yes, I am retiring. I was a little bit worried there. I do have meetings up until the last minute, but I thought July 1st was free. So thank you, Kevin. Working through the Wellness Committee throughout this year, we had a lot of different things that actually happened working up until we closed. We had worked with the Youth Mental First Aid Group, and hopefully we'll be able to offer that again maybe in the fall or in the spring. It's really great for parents and teachers who are not counselors to understand what that means and how to talk to kids about mental health issues, and that went really well, and I definitely recommend moving forward with that. We looked at a couple of different things throughout the year. We had our special education fair. We had our mental health fair. We looked at building community circles. It was really all about bringing people together with those restorative circles and building those bridges of trust. After school closed, the buildings continued to work on those building those bridges of trust in a variety of ways. It was really quite amazing what each individual building did during the shutdown. There were weekly staff meetings, there were postings, positive cards that went home to kids and to families and to faculty. There were all sorts of events that happened via Zoom, whether they were end of the year happy hours, and they went to the retirees' houses and did videos for them and brought gifts and set up signs, and everybody knows everything that happened that's going on for the seniors and all the different things that were happening. At Council Rock, every teacher received a handwritten note and a packet of seeds to brighten their day. Teachers received little care packages the last week with treats and messages. They were really trying very, very hard to keep people together and to continue those circles that have been happening throughout the year. We're going to continue with that going into the fall, and Betsy Balling will actually be working a lot continuing with the restorative practice and continuing building those bridges with kids, families. It was amazing what happened throughout this year and during the shutdown. Okay, Deb.
All right. So I'm up next. I think near and dear to my heart, obviously, is the blueprint goal around rigor for all students. That really tasks us to take a look at how we're reaching each and every student every day, and really trying to meet their needs. And so this notion of ongoing work is work that we've put in place for the last few years, but we continue to keep this in our blueprint just so make sure that it's at the front and center. So, you know, our ongoing systems around program evaluation, our, you know, grading conversations that we've had, and even over the last few years, really codifying how we develop curriculum to make sure that it's culturally responsive.
really, you know, goes a long way towards making us or ensuring that we do have rigor for all students. And then the other area of kind of an ongoing that it's always out there is this idea of promoting creativity and innovation. And we do that through personalizing opportunities for students. Never before, you know, since COVID especially, have we been able to do that, really focusing on what each individual child needs and how we're going to meet those needs, either through actual support, online support, amazing things that our teachers are doing each and every day to make sure that our students are being successful. Again, continuing this notion of cultures of thinking through our classroom, and for, you know, teachers that are in a classroom, that's really around instilling inquiry-based projects, making thinking visible, learning routines, discourse. All of those routines, project-based learning, all fall within these categories that we just do as kind of a way we do business that really provide for all of our students. This year, our focus, our spotlight, if you will, really highlighted a couple of different areas. One, kind of this umbrella of mental health, looking at how we handle homework and how homework is looked at and how it's implemented in a K-12 fashion. And so Deanna Spagnola headed up a group of our curriculum council that really took a look at what were our practices across all of our buildings, and was there a way that we could make sure that those were congruent with one another, as well as really reflected best practice. And they did a lot of deep research, a lot of deep reading, and really understood, you know, to grow in an understanding that homework looks really different, and there are varying opinions as well as research bases with regards to the role homework plays in the student learning process. And then I know that Tom and Rob this year also took a look at homework specifically within their buildings, and really, again, in an attempt to try to kind of create congruency as students progressed up through the grade levels. Within the area of culturally responsive practices, a subgroup that I headed up in Curriculum Council a year ago, we really focused on curriculum and what did that mean to develop culturally responsive curriculum, and identified some tools that we could use to make sure that that was happening. And this year we really focused on, again, on instruction. And we really used the work of Zaretta Hammond, which is kind of the basis for rigor and how we provide rigorous opportunities for all students. And so again, the good news was we learned much of what we were currently having in place, what we were doing, really was aligned to the recommendations coming out of that study. We also brought in some of the habits of mind thinking, the habits of mind learning that Council Rock has been doing over the last few years to see how we might scale that thinking all the way up through 12th grade. And then again, looked at like how our some of our focuses on flexible learning spaces, how that pushed into or aligned to those goals as well. And then Mike Lehner did a fabulous job, particularly in the last 3 months, really helping teachers understand what are the positive ways we can use technology to facilitate student learning. So moving forward, what we see happening in the next school year under mental health, we know that in the fall, even though we don't know what's going to be happening, we know that building relationships is going to be absolutely key. Many of our teachers this year have commented on the fact that the reason that students were successful in this last quarter was a direct result of the relationships they had built with them in the first three quarters. And so we're really trying to study in a deeper sort of way what that means and what that might look like if in fact we're forced to start the school year online and we have to build those relationships virtually. With regards to culture responsive practices, I'm sure everybody has at this point read Kevin's latest email or communication to staff, and how we really need to shine the light on on the teaching that we do, starting at our very youngest ages, for anti-racist, anti-bias curriculum. And what are we doing about that? Making sure that all of our students are really understanding and learning why this is incredibly important. And then also looking at the intersectionality between our culture responsive practices and all the other district initiatives, so that teachers really can see how they are entwined in most of our work. And then again, we will continue to look at technology and how we can use that to support individual student learning, particularly in the area of professional development. Our staff have done an incredible job up to this point, but we will continue to help them understand and grow and learn in this particular area.
And now I think it's Lou's, and we're moving to our Diversity and Equity Committee and the work of that committee.
Great. Good evening, everyone. So the work of the Hiring Practices Committee has been really defined in three buckets, interconnected but buckets. There's the recruitment playbook, and then there's environment and retention. And environment and retention, we've kind of grouped together. The environment retention, not a lot to report right now, but as the superintendent laid out in his communication, that's where we're going to be doubling down our efforts in the upcoming months and the upcoming school year. Specific to report tonight, though, is the progress made on our recruitment of diversifying our teaching faculty and administrative faculty. So you could see on the right-hand side what our charge was, and the areas highlighted in green are where we focused our efforts this year. And it's really looking at our hiring practices, defining what those protocols are to ensure fairness and consistency in our hiring practice, and then our playbook for increasing the diversification of the candidates, the number of candidates that are moving to committee then, and then are being considered for teaching and administrative positions. Deb, if we can move on, I appreciate it. Thanks. So what we have here is, again, focusing on the recruitment where we spent most of our time this year, showing where we've been intentional about increasing, you know, the net of where we're recruiting. So what we've highlighted here is our strategies. And these are all strategies that were developed by the Hiring Practices Committee. And again, that's a cross-section of professionals across different industries, trying to bring best practices in hiring to public education. So you can see where we focus, where we've invested, and you can see in the newspaper strategies, NEMNET, which is a minority recruitment firm, diversity in education, targeting the historically Black colleges and university, trying to tap into their networks of professionals, the National Alliance of Black Educators, the Out Alliance, and then what was a new strategy for us this year is the nomination form, trying to have our community tap out professionals that they know. It's kind of an unspoken rule that you don't recruit from your colleagues. So we tried to circumvent that by using our wide network of community members and try to tap professionals to bring interest to our openings. And on the right-hand side is the specific strategies to really show our intentionality. So starting with the job posting, including a diversity statement, which you could read there, and then requiring or our commitment to diversity statement that's included in our job application, and then requiring a diversity statement, a written statement, to be submitted by all applicants. So the committee members and the screening teams can get a sense of how they may answer the question that Dr. McGowan always asks them, how will you make us better? So we had a written sample size of that. And so one of the other things that was in our playbook, something that was really important to the Hiring Practices Committee, is measures of success. So Debbie, we can move to the next slide. So this is just one measure of success on the recruitment side. And so this is our screening results. So we had 48 candidates for the TCMS principal position. Of those, 21 members were screened, and we looked at, and this is something we haven't done before, so I don't have a good history, but something we've committed to going forward to measure our success. So 31% of the applicants screened were female, 31% were persons of color, administrators of color, and 38% were Caucasian males. So again, just one small measure of success to see if our recruiting strategies were showing a return on investment. We were very pleased with that. We consulted with Marla Washington and Renee through the process, and we wanted to make sure that we were executing the playbook with fidelity and with intentionality. That being said, Debbie, if we can go to the next slide, we had some hiccups, we had some bumps in the road, and some things that we learned from that will guide our work going into the summer and into the fall. So here's our recommendations for moving forward. Again, learning from our experience in the recent search processes, making sure that we're updating things, looking at our protocols to ensure fairness and consistency in our process. That's going to mean more training for our hiring committee members, compiling more objective feedback from the hiring committee. And then in response to Dr. McGowan's letter to the community and again, doubling down our efforts in the environment and retention attributes. We know we need to full speed ahead in the anti-racist, anti-bias training series. So it's not just a check-the-box training. We are committed to developing a robust professional development series. And one of the terms that Renee Baker has brought to us is allies and advocates. So we want a train the trainer series that we're going to work with the Brighton Teacher Center to develop, have teachers and administrators go through that series. And then we're going to develop a, from a compliance standpoint, not again, check the box, but an intentional, being very intentional in anti-racist and anti-bias training. And then one of the other things that we touched on in the beginning of the year that we need to go faster on is under the environment and retention is we did, as part of our meetings, we did a building walkthrough. And we had somebody walk through and just looking at the artifacts that are on the walls, the environment that's created with how our buildings present, how they present to potential candidates, how they present to our current faculty and staff. And she had a lot of suggestions for improvement. So we're going to work with Marla Washington and work with, she is a social worker by trade, but she's going to come in and help us invest in our buildings to help create the environment that that shows our commitment to diversification and promoting promoting diversity. With that, I move on. Appreciate it.
All right. Okay, so my subgroup on the Diversity Equity Committee, excuse me, was family engagement. And we really spent this year kind of taking a look. Actually, let me back up. The first year that we met, really spent a ton of time not only surveying our community, but really looking at the research around what could we do to increase or ensure that our families felt welcome and connected. And so this year we put some strategies in place. And so we had basically it was just an updating or a monitoring of those strategies. First, what we did was we worked with the PTSA to create a formal family liaison position in each one of the buildings. And this person, really the point of that was to reach out to families new to the district, really welcome them to the district, answer questions that they might have, and really connect them and help them better, you know, navigate, if you will, through the Brighton system. In addition, we supported the increased FTEs of our family navigator position, along with the continued employment of Dr. Washington Marlow for being our diversity consultant. Third, we really looked at the barriers to family participation, particularly in areas of our curriculum nights or our parent-teacher conferences. And I worked with actually a subgroup of the subgroup at French Road to really kind of start to do to employ some specific strategies within the curriculum night to really help families not only get to know one another, to help them feel welcome, to help them feel like they were well a part of the Brighton community. And then also took a look at just kind of some structural areas that we had. You know, the timing of our conferences, were they convenient to parents? Did parents feel like they could participate in those without too much conflict within their own lives? And so if we took a look at all of those, we saw that we actually made some inroads, particularly, I want to say, at Council Rock and French Road with regards to curriculum night, providing babysitting, or actually in some instances, inviting students to attend during those times, and really helping families to feel like they could participate. I think another big area that we found really had the most leverage or the most input was in our, during curriculum nights, actually running community building circles with some of our families. Teachers who did that really reported having amazing results throughout the year with families really feeling like they were connected because they'd taken the time during curriculum nights to really build that sense of community. So moving forward, just kind of continuing with those particular recommendations, one is continuing to work with PTSA to, again, kind of codify the roles of those parent liaisons, kind of maybe shore up and make sure that they have all the information that they need so that they can reach out, as well as our own systems that allow us to communicate with the parent liaisons when we do have a new family moving into the district. Also taking a look at and perhaps running a parent survey about what worked especially during the time of COVID. You know, what did families, what did we do that helped them to feel connected, helped them to feel like they were connected with the success of their children? And can we learn from those strategies and then scale those when we're in a real-time environment? Looking at ways of supporting families with the technology. We're just in the initial stages of analyzing the data. We had over almost 900 families weigh in on the experiences of their children during this time, and really taking a look at what were some of the barriers, if you will, to families and using some of the technology, and can we somehow bridge those barriers by helping families learn better how they can assist their students, again, using that technology. And then last year, although we didn't get to use it, we really updated and modified our survey to new families, really to try to ascertain what works in helping you stay connected and helping you feel like you're a welcome member of the Brighton community. And so we'd like to plan to use that, maybe perhaps with all of our families, so that we can gauge more insight into what we can do to ensure family connectedness. And now, Carolyn, I think this is you.
It is. And as I was looking, kind of scanning through these slides, I was trying to remember where we were and what was happening. Looking at our slide and thinking about what's happened, it seems like, what's taking you so long? You know, and I look at what we have done over the past 3 years specifically, and I just want to emphasize that this is a very long process. These conversations are very, very difficult. Looking at our unconscious bias and some of the practices that we have, and really taking them and depersonalizing them and looking at how we are interacting with kids and how we are providing special education. So in 2018-19, just a quick review, we went through our data and we had some data cleanup issues, and we ran into a lot of different things throughout the year, talking about the number of students that are classified who are African American, and looking at their different programs and looking at how we service kids. Then this past year, we really were trying to look at our beliefs, policies, and practices that support the biases that cause these disproportionalities. As we worked through this, and luckily, we did a lot of work at the beginning of the year and throughout before the shutdown, and we were right at a point of really starting to implement something that we, as a pilot, that's something that we developed. And we developed a conversation, what we're calling a conversation guidance document, to be utilized in structured conversations about all students. So when we talk about response to intervention or Brighton support team or any conversations about students during school, whether they're struggling learners academically, socially, behaviorally, whatever that is, we have developed a conversation document that has some questions that we're actually not even going to put the child's name at the top of. It's really to guide our conversation, and it has questions that may specifically help us think about a situation in a different way. So the questions that we're looking at are, how can we talk about this differently based on the information that we have? How could this information be impacting the student? And how do the instructional practices in our classrooms support this child's needs? And we're going to be trying to look deeply into the background of the child. If there's any psychiatric or psychological issues, social, emotional issues, what kind of trauma has the child had? Does the child have to take the bus to school? Does that impact how things work for that child? Who does the child live with? Just a lot of different things that we may not have addressed in the past. So that next year at this time, the goal is to have a pile of all of this data that says, we talked about this many children of color, or this many children who are walkers in our district, or it seems like we have children who move into the district struggle. We'll be able to divide the data in real time in real Brighton children about exactly how the conversations that we're having. But because we're gonna keep the names off of these pieces of paper and off of these guidance documents, we're really gonna be able to look at the data without personalizing it. A consequence of this, hopefully, is that when we're talking about kids, we'll consider these things. What kind of trauma has the child had? Do they have access to the technology that they need? Do they have access to the learning structures at home that other kids may or may not have? So we'll be able to hopefully look deeper and get kids what they need in a different way. So we'll be talking more deeply about this at the Blueprint also. So we're really, really excited to start to collect that data. And next year at this time, when I am retired, you will be able to take a look at that information. And I think you can move on.
Hi, everybody. So I'm going to talk about restorative practices. And I have to begin by saying I couldn't be more proud of the work that we've done with restorative practices this year. And who would have thought that something as unbelievable as COVID-19 would happen, and we would have done all this work early in the year to really start to create not only those connections between students, but also between staff members. And I think it has just been incredible. We had some really lofty goals. We wanted to implement restorative practices district-wide, and we were able to do that. We rolled out a fantastic conference day, and it was one of those days that was planned with so many different minds over a long period of time. It included teachers, teaching assistants, mental health staff, clerical staff, and administrators. And we used the different mental health staff, teaching assistants, admins, teachers that were all trained by PERI last summer to help deliver this instruction, and it was absolutely fantastic. It looked a little different K-5 than it did 6-12, but it served the purpose and it was just wonderful. We wanted to establish district and building level restorative practices committees. All of the buildings had separate committees. Those met monthly. They shared and implemented different ways in which circles could be used in the schools. And we also, together as a district committee with input from the different buildings, planned that conference day in October. We continue to work with partners in restorative initiatives, and one of those trainings actually happened. So we did a train the trainer in September. So all of the people who had been trained last summer actually attended a day at PERI, and then we used part of that day for planning our October conference day. We also planned somewhere between March and June of this year to have teachers trained in academic circles. That was supposed to be a one-day training, and have admins and mental health staff trained in restorative discipline. And that was a two-day training, and we decided to postpone that because one of the values of being together in a circle is to actually see each other in 3D, be able to interact, have those bonds that are formed. And so we decided to wait and do that, not over Zoom, but do it when we could be in person. And then we added a statement about restorative practices in the district code of conduct. We did that last September. And, you know, that was just a great way to kick off the year and say, this is truly important to us, and it's going to inform our practices going forward. So one of the things I put on here was just reminding people of the importance of circles during COVID-19. Benefits of restorative practices and community building circles, just as a reminder, the purpose is to form connections and strengthen relationships, repair harm, restore peace to families and communities, reduce violence, and promote healing. And there is no better time to keep this going, because this is going to be our new normal, whether we are remote or hybrid or a combination of a lot of different things. Forming these connections and promoting healing, not only with the staff, but with the students, is so important. I was talking to Amy Shield Jones, who used to work in Rochester with TIG, still does some work with them, and now is a consultant. And she said, Betsy, you need to remember that adults and students are trying to work from home in the midst of a crisis. And I would say we are not in the middle of a crisis anymore, but we have got to figure out a way to continue to get people back to a normal and to continue to build resiliency, and circles can certainly help to do that. So some examples of what was done with restorative practices during COVID-19. I was able to ask the different buildings what they've been doing. So at Council Rock and Fres, they've been having community building circles to maintain connections. And those have been done over Zoom. And it was shared with me that sometimes siblings and family members join in, which I thought was just great. Teaching assistants reached out to students who they connected with during recess just to keep those connections going. Teachers use Check and Connect weekly class meetings. And then I know Path Classroom teachers used this for community meetings where there would be teachers and counselors. It was a consistent format. There were games,
there were games,
and lots of things that they could do, just reaching out to keep the kids engaged. At TCMS and BHS, they use circle format while doing Zoom lessons. And I thought of, you know, so many of the different meetings that we've been a part of as faculty are really done in a circle format without even realizing that's how you do it. You start by just checking in. How are y'all doing? You get to the meat of what you need to talk about. And then at the end, you can, you know, you do a short activity at the end or you check in one more time. And then also during the meeting, and I can say this for at least how our coordinators meetings worked at the high school, we really got to know each other quite well because we spent so much time together. And so lots of connections were made there with staff, and that was really important. And then again, at the middle school, the staff and PATH classroom teachers use circle formats while running groups. Okay, last slide. So recommendations for 2020-21 are we are going to need to continue to build connections. And as we enter the new school year, not knowing exactly what that will look like, part of the big concern is, well, how are we going to connect with kids and get to know them? So we know that the staff is going to need this connection, students are going to need the connection, and there needs to be a lot of communication, a lot of empathy, and a lot of compassion. I've been fortunate enough to join a social emotional learning leaders community, and it's led by Mary Beth Elko at BOCES, and she's giving some great strategies for engagement and some best practices through CASEL, which is the Collaborative for Academic, Social, and Emotional Learning. And I've been on these, and I've been able to share some of the things that we've been doing in those meetings with the mental health staff while we've been out. We're also working on the District Professional Day for the mental health staff, and it will focus on social emotional learning and working together on how to establish to deliver services if we're learning remotely or in a hybrid model. So we need to establish strategies for not only how to work with students, but also how teachers can build connections when the year begins. And I said Mary Beth Elko was running the leaders community. Well, she has agreed to consult with us. We are thrilled to have her as part of that day at the end of August. And then we want to build internal capacity around restorative communities and restorative practices. So our intention is when we can get back together and see each other face to face that we do the academic circle training by PERI and that we have the restorative discipline training by PERI for administrators and mental health staff. And I'm just really looking forward to all the really great and creative ways that we continue to go forward with restorative practices. And I know in working at the high school this year, just to see the way that we have used the restorative practices in working things out with kids and helping them to navigate. And it's just allowed for more stories to be told, people are more open to listening, and I really think that families are feeling supported, and so are our staff members.
All right, so I think that wraps up our presentation, if there are any questions.
Questions, comments from any of the board? Well, thank you to the whole group. We appreciated it. And, you know, it's amazing when we, when I look through the material online and look through all the different presentations, you know, you realize what a year it's been. And the, I mean, it seems like two-thirds of the year we've been in the current state, right? But it was the other way around. And the connection and the way that all of the blueprint work did progress through the year, albeit a little difficult, obviously, when we stopped all being in person, but a lot of the work did continue. And I think each of you that spoke, you know, made remarks around, we've got to find a way to continue connectedness and find a way to keep work flowing and not, we know we're going to live in a world that's going to be some sort of a hybrid world for a while in terms of online versus in person. We just don't know what. But we can't put everything on the back burner and or on the shelf and just wait, right? So I think everybody's done a great job of trying to think about that and how would that look and how do you work through restorative practices and all the social emotional aspects of reaching out in mostly virtual world. So we appreciate everybody's thought on that. We look forward to blueprint work beginning pretty quickly again in the new version. So we will move on now to our report section, if that's okay with folks. Our financial report. We have from Lou and Dolly in the business office, a summary, executive summary budget status report. We have the reserve fund updated plan from Lou. And we also have the treasurer's report. May we have a motion from the board to accept those reports, please?
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Marv, seconded by Larry. Does anyone have any question, comment, anything for Lou? Ben, Kim, your internet is currently working?
Yeah, I'm here.
Thank you.
Andrea?
Aye.
Mary?
Aye.
Julian?
Aye.
Karen?
Aye.
Mark?
Aye.
Christina?
Aye.
Marv?
Yes.
Our Board of Education reports section, our Monroe County School Boards Association reports, obviously those have been on hiatus for the last couple of months. The three standing committees have chosen not to meet virtually. Sherry and Becky in the office are working very hard at keeping connections with legislative work and with NISBA and all the other agencies that they work with. They're also trying to plan right now on how next year might look. And they're making, like we all are, a couple of alternative type plans. They've worked with the DoubleTree, as the board knows. DoubleTree is our host for our standing committee meetings. And they've worked out arrangements for social distancing using their large ballrooms if we want to try to start doing something like that. And they actually may run a new board member governance training in that fashion at the end of July. That will solely depend on, well, it'll depend on a couple of things, but right now it'll depend on who chooses to sign up. And if enough new board members choose to take advantage of that opportunity that way, they'll run it. If not, they're going to push it out further into the fall, because all those of us who've taken that training know the importance of doing that in person together versus online. So that's kind of where that is. The board president's group continues to meet via Zoom twice a month. That's been really great discussion. We've had more participation from more board presidents than we have had when we met in person. And we meet tomorrow night with the leadership team from NISBA, Bob Schneider, Jay Warona, and I think, I can't remember, one of the other are going to join us and discuss NISBA's role and where things are and directionally moving forward and some of the ways that some of the board presidents would like to see them focus more of their efforts. So that's kind of currently where things are with Monroe County School Boards Association. Marv, do you have anything to sort, have anything with regard to BOCES for us?
Nothing now, but in the future, I'll be sending you reports. I'll type them up and send them an email or tell them to you in person.
I'll tell you what, I'll contact Sora directly and we'll have her do other things.
Better yet.
Busy with other things.
Better yet.
So thank you very much. Other board member reports. Normally you use this section to discuss individual board member activities. Does anyone have anything they wish to add at this this point in the meeting?
We had our normal OACM meeting yesterday, Mark, for high school, middle school, French Road. You obviously heard most of the updates from Lou during the construction piece. You know, there's, I won't say there's benefits, but there's obviously some advantages when the schools are empty to get going, but the contractors are also doing social distancing. I don't know that Lou hit this one specifically, but basically the electric in the high school is turned up. You can see that the new flying V that's in front of the junction box there is up, and the landscaping was done, but most of the electrical work associated with that is up and running in the high school, which was a nice step forward. And I think he hit the Council Rock piece. It's just going to continue to be a lot of noise, and it really will be great when it's done, but it will be a painful path to get there.
Thank you for that update, Larry, and we thank you for your service on that committee and keeping things moving forward on that. Any other board members have anything they wish to add at this point? Okay, then we will move on to our Brighton Teachers Association report. Nicole is here. I saw her earlier, and we have her report posted online. Nicole, welcome.
How are you? I feel like I should do what I do with the kids and have everybody stand up and do some jumping jacks, or we could do a movement break. We've been sitting for a while, so. But maybe just a big, deep breath. But at least I have fun things to share about some of the great things that teachers have been doing. So something really wonderful that Extended Studies did at Council Rock, sorry, my puppy dog's barking in the background, is they sent out their lessons virtually to all students. Whereas it may have just reached a smaller population, all students had access to Extended Studies, and it was really wonderful. In first grade, they did a Shakespeare unit. 70% of the first graders participated in that. So that's pretty remarkable number. They illustrated facts about Shakespeare that they turned into a grade level book. They visualized the forest from A Midsummer Night's Dream and illustrated. They also learned fairy lines and prepared flowers for Queen Titiana's arrival. They heard part of the story and used finger puppets to tell the story. And then students who completed all of the activities were entered into a raffle where they could get a Magic Treehouse book where the characters go back to Elizabethan England and meet William Shakespeare. And a Council Rock mom, Rita Minnelli, donated 20 copies of the book for students to be able to use. So that's pretty amazing. You guys have the link on your report to be able to view the students' work. For Play Day, Kristen Cooper, along with Mrs. Jeffries and Mr. Tappan, made a virtual Play Day. Play Days are big event where all the families come and we have teams and t-shirts, beautifully tie-dyed t-shirts, games, and because we couldn't do that together, we did it virtually, thanks to Mrs. Cooper. Mrs. Tisa's kindergarten class had stayed socially connected by having a share and show, kind of like a show and tell, but via Zoom. And then all of the kindergarten teachers did farewell to kindergarten visits where they went to every kindergartner's house and stopped and wished them good luck to go on to first grade. So that was pretty beautiful. The first grade team did a phenomenal job embracing distance learning. They really were the model, I think, for at least our grade level two, second grade. They stayed unified with the learning goals, but also really individualized all of the lessons for their classes. They are very excited to celebrate the tenure of Rachel O'Gorman, who was a big driver, a leader for what we were able to do virtually as the first grade team. They really felt that they did a great job implementing and navigating best support practices, access to all sorts of programming. They used text to support our Road to Reading program, which is our big push. And they did a lot of that heavy lifting, and that was just wonderful to be able to share. Using all the new technologies, they did habits of mind, peace circles, restorative practices, all of this via Zoom. And then really trying to reach all students who may have needed any kind of extra support. At Frez, they had already been trained in Seesaw by Ellen Harp, and she wanted to make sure that she shared how valuable technology classes are in having students prepared. This summer, they will have optional resources, especially for the fifth graders going into 12 corners that they can continue to work on. Also, the Frez music teachers made many virtual lessons to send out via Zoom and Seesaw. And one of the things they shared was, and this is something that I experience too with my own classroom, is all the siblings that were gathered whenever we would do a lesson. We would have younger siblings, older siblings, and it was kind of wonderful to be able to greet them. And one of the things that the music teachers really noticed was that the younger siblings were learning the songs along with the siblings of, or along with the students at Frez. Miss Mix, who does the second steps at Frez, she, and I put the link in the report, she had these wonderful templates that students could sort of keep as a diary, check-ins about how you're doing, which she had some amazing responses. If you read, I put a few pictures in, but I also have the link to some of the others. Really a wonderful idea to have kids engaged and kind of communicating. At 12 Corners, Maria Casetos' classes collaborated with French Road, both the fifth grade and the third grade. So they wrote letters to fifth graders, welcoming them to 12 Corners, had Zoom sessions with classes. And then the sixth grade wrote fables for the third grade and shared those via Zoom. So it was a great, you know, you make lemonade. It was a great way to get connections that we're always hoping we get in person that we had through this whole pandemic. Jim Lanson, a long-term sub at TCMS, was the person who contacted Pam Melroy, who was the retired astronaut, and she was Zoom conferencing with some of the students, so that's a real opportunity. That was about a week ago, 2 weeks ago. And the eighth grade band and orchestra did a collaboration long distance to record a final project for the instrumental ensemble. At the high school, Heather Bonadonna's juniors were able to meet via Zoom with Kathleen Grissom, who wrote The Kitchen House, which was a book that they were all reading. And then on May 22nd, AIM teachers assembled and delivered notes and bags to all the students in the AIM program. They really wanted to make sure that they were connecting to AIM students. They celebrated their seniors, and I put some pictures in there along with a link for the video that they took. So there were actually more people emailing, trying to get more things into the report. It's interesting that during this time, I had so many people wanting to contribute. So lots of great stuff.
Fantastic, Nicole. Thank you very much. And again, thank you for the look into all the work that's going on. As we keep, you know, discussing every meeting, learning is learning, and it's not in a building, it's going on every day, or it had been. And I love in the report, especially, I'm appreciative of all of the links that you put in there and additional information, especially the student work that we can find moving on to. So thank you so much. And thank you for everything this year you've done. And you've done a great job on behalf of the BTA reporting out, and we certainly have appreciated your efforts in that regard. So thank you so much. Maybe we'll see you again. That's That'd be great too, so whichever works. I don't believe, Kim, we have a PTSA representative here this evening for a report.
No, they didn't submit a report. I don't see anybody on either.
There's a lot going on this time of the year, and it was a change date, so that will be fine. If we get a report from them later, we can add it to the minutes. Dr. McGowan, superintendent report, please.
Just a couple of brief comments. One, we have the Blueprint Day coming on the 29th. If you got a sense from the Blueprint reports before, the incredible planning that happens on that day, the collective work resulting in everything through the year that was described in those reports. We're looking forward to that. Community members received an email with an opportunity to sign up, and we would encourage them to continue to enter feedback into an exchange. Thought Exchange will be open through the end of the week, and a reminder will go tomorrow with the link again, so people should offer their feedback, and certainly if people like to volunteer, send that in right away. We'd love to have them join us next Monday. It'll be sort of a transitional blueprint next year, a little bit different, even than what was presented tonight, focused very much directly on diversity equity issues and on reopening. We have limited resources relative to organizational capacity and in terms of financial resources, and we recognize the need to be very streamlined and focused in our work going into next year, those being the two primary areas that we will be working on. And in terms of reopening, it really will be an opportunity to collect a lot of feedback from groups of people with no guidance yet whatsoever, no really good sense from the state, either the education department or the governor yet, what will be required of schools or how that will look. But we need to be ready to plan very, very quickly when that time comes. And so this opportunity to gather feedback on different scenarios. What if it looked like this? What if we had to do this? What about this, or this? Will be key. So we're getting a lot of feedback through the exchange. There's 300 people in already. I'd like to hear more questions, comments, suggestions, feedback. But then on that day as well, to be able to get together with focus groups and bounce ideas off of them so that we're really well positioned to be facile in our planning over the summer as soon as we do get some more guidance from the state. And I would just finish with two comments of thanks and congratulations. One, to the community for their support. First of all, with regard to the budget, 83% of our community members who voting yes. We can't tell you how much we appreciate that vote of confidence in the work, but that understanding of the need for a financial commitment that we don't take lightly. And we don't take lightly the faith that people put in us and the need to safeguard those resources and be efficient and effective in our work. We recognize our role in that, and we will continue to uphold our obligation, of course, and live up to the trust that the community has placed in us. To our staff and to our community, families who did so much to support their kids at home, staff who did so much to support kids at home in a completely unprecedented, the words are just superfluous at this point, unprecedented, unpredicted, unbelievable. It was all of those things. It was all the un-things, right? Nobody would have ever seen this coming in this way. It affected every single person and family in very different ways. And we made it through. We got to a point here at the end of the year where a lot of great work was done. We learned a tremendous amount. We are different because of it. And I hope to think over time that we're better because of it. And that we think differently about our connections to each other. We think differently about the time we spend with each other. We think differently about the incredible opportunity we have to be around each other every day when now we don't. And all the things that distance did to help us innovate and think differently about the work. And so we'll move forward trying to, of course, be back in front of each other, but to learn lessons from the experience. That's really the best thing we can do with reflecting in the last few months. And last but certainly not least, to the class of 2020. I'm seeing it firsthand, of course, as a parent in that class, as is Christina and Karen, and I know that everybody feels this. Today, there was a great session, a drive-through to pick up cap and gown and signs that were supported by the Chamber of Commerce, the Brighton Chamber, by Brighton Kiwanis, and by Brighton Rotary, and just an opportunity for the staff to cheer on our kids. And I know three of us saw firsthand, as participants in that,
Hi.
How much that meant to kids, and just the sense of closure that was achieved, if only briefly. And just how emotional that was. And it was a reminder also of what we missed so far, but also a reminder of how close and connected this community is and how much they care about the class of 2020. And I know tonight was a bit of a rain out in some ways. The parade, it still sounds from what I'm gathering, was pretty spirited. I think in some ways it was was almost par for the course for the class of 2020, that there was a torrential downpour during the parade. But of course, they trooped through it. Our parents organized it. It was a wonderful event, and they took it for what it was. And congratulations to them. 210 of our nearly 300 graduates will participate in an individual program tomorrow, and we sincerely hope to be able to have a larger ceremony on August 9th and are still planning for that. And if that doesn't work, then we'll still have the individual program on August 9th for those that didn't participate tomorrow. So doing everything we can to celebrate them. But this is quite a testament to who they are and how they will be well prepared going forward. So congratulations to them as well. Thanks.
Great. Thank you very much, Kevin, and very well said. And we've talked to all of our students and families graduating, and you're absolutely right. It's hopefully it will be the most unique class in decades, and they will have stories forever and ever. And it's a little hard to envision that right now, but each of their days right now are unique experiences. And you know, tomorrow will be great, and hopefully we can do what we plan to do in August and give them a send-off then too. So thank you, and thanks to everybody that's making that happen. All of we talk about Tom and the fact that he doesn't sleep, but everybody at the high school especially, but our staff, our teachers in all of the buildings who turned out today and who have turned out for so many events, honoring not just our seniors, but our eighth graders and our French Road kids, our Council Rock kids, the different activities that our teachers and staff have tried to put together this year to make a connection here and there in person when they've been able to do that with kids. And it's made a difference. So our thanks to everybody for all of those activities. We have a section of 8 bids this evening. Unless anyone has an objection, I would ask for a motion to approve all 8 bids. These are cooperative bids, and we've often discussed we're part of a bidding consortium that is done through the BOCES 2 purchasing office, which ensures us the best and lowest possible prices for all of these type commodity projects. These 8 bids, 6 of them involve school lunch supplies in one shape or form. One is athletic supplies, and one is around our natural gas supply. So if we could have a motion, please, to approve those bids as prepared by Lou and cooperatively bid through BOCES 2, I would appreciate it.
Sorry.
That's okay. Moved by Larry and seconded by Julene. Kim, would you call the roll, please?
Andrea?
Aye.
Larry?
Aye.
Julene?
Aye.
Karen?
Aye.
Mark?
Aye.
Christina?
Aye.
Marv?
Yes.
Next item of business, speaking of the cooperative bidding process and BOCES 2's role in that, we have a resolution prepared by Kim for approval and certification of the designation of the purchasing agent for BOCES, Monroe 2 Orleans BOCES, to enter into any and all cooperative bidding ventures for the upcoming 2020-2021 school year. Motion, please.
So moved. So moved.
Second.
Moved by Marv, seconded by Karen. Tim, please.
Andrea?
Aye.
Larry?
Aye.
Julene?
Aye.
Karen?
Aye.
Mark?
Aye.
Christina?
Aye.
Marv?
Yes.
And we have a few items now that relate to tentative agreements with the district. Agenda item number 11, approval of the tentative agreement between the Association for Brighton Administrators and the Brighton Central School District. The motion to approve.
So move.
Second.
Moved by Andrea, seconded by Christina. Anyone have any questions or anything further on that? Kim, please.
Andrea?
Aye.
Larry?
Aye.
Julene?
Aye.
Karen?
Aye.
Mark?
Aye.
Christina?
Aye.
Marv?
Yes.
Thank you. Motion, please, for approval of the tentative agreement between the Brighton Academic Support Instructors and the district, please.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Marv, seconded by Karen. Thank you very much. Kim?
Andrea?
Aye.
Larry?
Aye.
Julene?
Aye.
Karen? Mark.
Aye.
Christina.
Aye.
Mark.
Yes.
And also, please, a motion to approve an extension to the employment contracts for our buildings and grounds, food service workers, school aides, non-teaching supervisors, and non-unit support. A motion, please.
So move.
Second.
Moved by Andrea and seconded by Christina. Kim?
Andrea.
Aye.
Larry?
Aye.
Julian?
Aye.
Karen?
Aye.
Mark?
Aye.
Christina?
Aye.
Barb?
Yes.
Thank you very much. And also now a motion, please, for approval of a JUUL agreement with a particular employee.
So move.
Second.
Moved by Marv, seconded by Julene. Kim?
Andrea?
Aye.
Larry?
Aye.
Julene?
Aye.
Karen?
Aye.
Mark?
Aye.
Christina?
Aye.
Marv?
Aye.
And finally this evening, Board, please, a motion to approve the consent agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Karen, seconded by Larry. I make note that the gifts this evening and the consent agenda are the latest from the Brighton Education Fund. Brighton Education Fund put those together and approvals in February and March, but because of a lot of circumstances, obviously, we're just getting to clean up a number of items. But tonight, very generous gifts totaling over $8,500 to all four buildings in the district from the Brighton Education Fund. And as is always the case, we're very appreciative of the group, the Board of Trustees that work on that, but especially the members of the community nearby and beyond who support the Brighton Education Fund through their financial donations. So we are very appreciative of that. Kim, would you call the roll, please?
Andrea?
Aye.
Larry?
Aye.
Julene?
Aye.
Karen?
Aye.
Mark?
Aye.
Christina?
Aye.
Marv?
Yes.
All of you people, stop texting me. The suggestions that are inappropriate. Anyway, that concludes the not only this evening's business meeting, but our final business meeting and final meeting of the year. We again thank Marv. We will post the slideshow tribute to Marv. We will make sure that gets posted.
Yes.
It will be part of the video posting of our meeting, but we will make sure that gets posted for all those who could share it. We appreciate all the former board members who joined in this evening, a number that couldn't, past superintendents and other folks like Harv and Gary. So we'll make sure that we get that to everybody. We thank Marv. Kevin mentioned Sue Gasparino. She joined us this evening. She's been on our board meetings for quite a while. We welcome her as a new board member. She's going to fill a role. She's not going to take a place of Marv, but we welcome her, and she'll be joining us at our July 2nd reorganization meeting. So is there any other items of business this evening, board members?
Nope.
Dr. McGowan?
It did not seem like Romicelli even once wanted to put his hand up to vote. I'm just saying. He did not even once try and jump in. So good to see you, Rome. And I just, again, can't thank Marv enough for his leadership, his guidance, his support, and his friendship. So I just wonder if everybody could, again, round of applause for Marv.
Thank you all.
We appreciate that. And Marv, Rome doesn't miss this one bit. That's why he's smiling. A motion to adjourn, please.
So moved.
Moved by Marv. Yes. Seconded by the group. Kim?
Andrea?
Aye.
Larry?
Aye.
Julene? Aye. Julene?
Aye.
Karen?
Aye.
Mark?
Aye.
Christina?
Aye.
Marv?
Aye.
Good night, everybody. We are adjourned. Thank you very much.
This has been a special presentation from the Brighton Central School District Board of Education.